are now looking at the actual Visual Studio code that creates the Excel Insulator project sample in Part 1. Within the code, there are only two windows of much interest. One is the window where the form itself is edited, and the other is the window where the code is given. So beginning with the form design, it's very easy to modify forms like this within Visual Studio, where you can grab sections and readily displace them, edit properties, and so on. You can set the default properties here. In this case, it's set to 40. If I want to make the default value 60, just type in 60 here. Every one of these boxes is given a simple reference name. For example, capacitor radius is given a name of C-rad, capacitor rounding is C-round, and so on. You can easily add and delete objects into the form. For example, I can put in a checkbox by grabbing it from the toolbar and dragging it in, and giving it a name of my choosing. Laying out the form itself is easy to use and straightforward. Modifying the code of the form means going to the form dialog. When you create a project in Visual Studio, there's a whole bunch of setup that's already done for you. The API documentation gives you the critical steps you need to set up a new form, but this is mostly typed in already. You can also use these as a template for something new. The general method for the form is that when we click on the Run button, you can see that the button will invoke a function called Run Scenario. Examining that function, you can see that Electro is going to increment the case number, which is used for the auto-saving demonstration. It will check to see if Electro is already open, and if it isn't open, it will invoke it again by calling for IES.document. Electro will be referred to within the code as underscore document. The code then proceeds to define a whole bunch of variables that are needed and to read their values out of the form. Within the form, the values are given as text, so you can see, for example, the variable CRAD is taken by converting to double the text value of the object named CRAD in the form. A whole bunch of variables are read out of the form into the code in order to perform manipulations. Once all the variables are in place, three names are created: top electrode, bottom electrode, and insulator, all within Electro. This is done by invoking underscore document, then invoking the API function object underscore create, then specifying the name of the created object, either top electrode, bottom electrode, or insulator. Some other setup is done within Electro, like specifying the length unit, again following the same format, underscore document, model underscore set unit, then using the unit read out of the form. The code then goes on to actually creating the geometry based on the various variables given. In the case of creating the insulator, because a different amount of sheds can be used, there's a for loop which will step through to create shed after shed according to the number specified. Once all geometry is created, the view limits are reset to show the entire geometry. The physics is then assigned, materials and voltages are assigned, and the model is solved. Once a solution is obtained, analysis is invoked to find out the maximum electric field on the selected segment. Then the values are recorded in the spreadsheet area. If autosave is checked, the model is saved to the name case number plus the actual number of the case being run, and streamlines are drawn with an Electro. Something worth noting about creating the code within Visual Studio is that Visual Studio is able to help you find functions of interest. As we start typing, we see that it presents us with a set of underscore options. As we start typing underscore D, we now have the option of choosing the document. When we put in the period, we now see a list of API functions that are available for underscore document. You can scroll through the list or start typing in letters. For example, G for geometry, or GET, means I'm now looking at get functions, so we can, for example, invoke the model getUnit. Now that we have the entire function name in place, as soon as I type, it's letting me know which variables it's going to need. Visual Studio provides a lot of help to save you having to memorize the various function names and the variables that must be passed within the function. Thank you.